the Stabycraft Game Chaser Transom, and this thing just backs up unbelievably well. You can fish right from the very tip here, right to the back corners. Everyone in the cockpit can see exactly what's happening below us. Big badass outriggers, 17 footers. To put them out to fish, locked into position, the lights flash to the rhythm of the music. This isn't a TV remote. This one is the one that I drive the boat from. Icy cold beer on tap. Push the joystick sideways, the boat moves sideways. We are 3D mapping the sea floor while we're doing 35 knots. Live sport. Ah, he got him!
Oi.
Yeah, cheer, bubba! Yes. Woo! Yes!
God, it's clocked light. In that moment, I clocked it.
Well, here she is, my new boat, the Stabycraft 2750. This is my second 2750. The first one was so good, I insisted on exactly the same hull. But after the benefit of 4 years operating my old boat, I've made some design improvements. There is things on this boat that you would only expect to see on big launches and the finest of big sport fishing boats, all incorporated into a trailer boat, along with some clever little bits of design, innovation, and practical ideas that will just make the boating and fishing experience a whole lot better. It's all been designed, built, and rigged meticulously, right from the tips of the riggers all the way down to the bottom of the keel. There's a whole lot of detail that's gone into this boat. From the very tip of the bow all the way through the boat, right to the stern. This boat has got so many clever ideas built into it, and I want to show you every inch of it. So, let's go. Well, right now, it's time for us to take you through this whole boat and show you all the detail, technology, products, and design that all combine to make for a better fishing experience. Now, there's going to be a lot of detail to be covered off. Wherever you see a graphic come across your screen like this, it means that there's more detail that you can see on ultimatefishing.tv on things like the electronics, the motor review, and even the intricate detail on the fishing setup. So right now, we're going to start off running through this boat, which is a trailer boat with a very important part, the trailer. Now, when we talk about trailer boats, we don't spend enough time actually looking at the trailer. And I think the same can be said for purchasing decisions. When people are buying a trailer boat, they just tend to take whatever trailer comes with the boat, which I think is crazy, given that such a huge part of trailer boating is getting the boat from home to the boat ramp safely. And when people are having hassles, it's quite often with their trailer. And more so, if your boat, your pride and joy, is ever going to get wrecked, it's most likely to happen on the road, not on the water. Which is why, for the last 5 trailers that I've had, I've insisted on Hoskins, and I've just avoided the hassles. And I mean, this thing, it's a big rig, and it tows amazing. And a big part of that, of course, is the Land Cruiser. There's plenty of trucks around that claim to tow 3.5 tonnes, but if you want to really tow 3.5 tonnes, the Land Cruiser, incredible towability. We're going to drill into a lot more detail on the trailer, on the setup, and tips for safe towing and transporting your boat. But right now it's time to slip this thing off the trailer, fire up this bad boy, and walk through the boat. Okay, so we're going to start right up here at the front, is where we've got some of the first design innovations and improvements, starting with these Hella XLB spotlights. They're a long-range spotlight, and I've got one beam shooting right forward to give me vision of everything in the distance, and I've got one angled down slightly to illuminate the water in front of me. Now, most people, when they rig spotlights on their boats, they go up on the roof, but as that light shines forward, it illuminates the bow rail, the foredeck, and it ruins your night vision. So I've had them built as far forward as they can go without going too far. So if you hit something, you're not going to break your lights. I've got a guard at the back just to block any light pollution. And I've got them angled so they don't illuminate the anchor. No wrecking my night vision, no light pollution, but maximum punch through forward. and I've achieved that by stacking two of those Hala lights. The anchor, slight change there from the last boat. I had that hidden away underneath the bowsprit. With this one, I've got it up a little bit higher so I can see the anchor. Last time round, I used to have to run a camera to be able to see the anchor. Anchor locker, I've got room in here for spare anchor, spare oil, spare ropes, bits and pieces, easy access. External access to my Maxwell drum winch. I'm a real fan of drum winches. Windlasses, the old style, spin around. Your chain tangles up, and as you try and put it out or even retrieve it, it gets twists, locks, jams. These, push the down button, anchor goes down, push the up button, anchor comes up. One omission from there is on this boat, I don't have a rope or chain counter like I did on the last boat. What I found is that it kept needing to be recalibrated. So instead, I've just marked the chain and the rope in 10 meter intervals. And because I can see it from the helm, I know exactly how much rope and chain I'm running out. Rod holders at the front. Because this is a fishing boat and this is bona fide fishing space, particularly top water gear, soft baiting gear, anything you're casting quite often gets done up the front here. So rod holder storage. Notice the nice flat platform up here. Nothing to kick your toes on. Good rail height, even when you're up on the platform, and I've gone to a thicker bell rail. So the thicker bell rail just means more sturdy, less vibration, and also there's no flex or movement in it. And you'll notice with this rail also, it's powder coated. So powder coating really hard, doesn't ding up. It's low reflective as well, so you don't get that sunlight bouncing back when you're at the helm. And it's also nice and grippy. It just feels really nice. And Stabycraft have gone to the powder coating for their bow rails and also the cabin, internally and externally. Not only is it a nice looking finish, hard wearing, but it actually protects all of the surfaces, and I love this stuff. And this whole bow rail, right from the very tip, the whole way back, has been designed so wherever I go, it stays in contact with my hip or my thigh. Now, most boats that you see out there with bow rails, they really go for form over function. So they flare them out to make the boat look bigger and look cool. Well, there's no point if your foot's here and your bow rail's here, you can't lean on it. You're gonna tip over, or you're gonna need to hold onto it. Well, when I'm up here, quite often, I'm wiring swordfish, wiring marlin or tuna, I'm fighting fish. It is just like a combing, it's secure, and it means that the walk around isn't just for walking around. It's legitimate fishing space. You can fish right from the very tip here, off the front, all the way down the sides, right to the back corners, which we're gonna get to now. And just as I'm coming around this walk around, another thing we've incorporated is a nice drain. So if you take any big waves over the bow, which you don't really do on these Stabycrafts, very dry boats, but if you're punching through some surf, beach launching, which I have done, this will take the water and it'll pump it away over the side, so you're not gonna be filling your cockpit up with water. Okay, coming down here into the cockpit where all the action happens, right in the center is the big 300 liter Icetech, which of course we know excellent coolers, keep ice cold for days. With this one, I've added a seat to make it multi-purpose like most things on this boat. So it's not just foam, it's closed cell foam. And if it's normal foam, it absorbs water because it's essentially a sponge. This won't absorb water, so good seat. At the back end here, utility tray with a nice lip around it. It stops stuff rattling around. Anything I grab out of the tackle drawers or even the drawers up front, I can plonk here and we can rig up without it disappearing. A few drink holders. I've gone for a split lid, which means I can open this side up and all my tackle and stuff that's sitting there isn't going to get disturbed. This bin is designed to take 9 of these bins, each with their own lids. So you can have different species of fish, you could have lunch in one of these, you could have your beers in one of these, anything you want to keep cold. And the good thing is, when you get back, you lift it out. You don't have to clean the whole Icetech bin out, which is like the communal gathering center area of the boat, and it's been designed with good access all the way around it because, after all, this is a fishing boat. But anyway, we're gonna come back to all the intricate fishing detail on the boat. First off, we're gonna take a look inside and we're gonna stop right here at the pillar. What I've done with the pillar here is I've brought a lot of the switches that traditionally live right up on the helm outside, because these are all the things that everyone wants to use when they're in the cockpit. So if someone says, can you flick the tuner tubes on? I'm not looking for looking through 50 switches up there for the tuner tubes. So we've got things like the live bait tank pump. Anyone from the helm, inside or out, can reach the live bait pump. And it's really neat in fact that you can turn the pump on, pump off, or flick it into timer mode. Now when it's in timer mode, you get to choose the time delay. You can have on, off, or on timer, which I use quite a lot when I'm sitting there anchored up, stray lining. You don't want the noise of the pump running all the time, but just turning on every now and then just to keep your baits alive. Things like the floodlights, step lights, bait tank light, bait board light, spotlight, underwater lights. This boat has got a huge array of lighting. Well, the switches are all here accessible for all. And we will cover the extensive lighting on this boat in the full lighting review, which we're going to do later on. Because once it gets dark, you're going to really see the benefits of having good lighting on a boat. Even things like bilge pump, washdown pumps, tuner tubes, electric reels, lights, and our floodlights out the back here, they're all here where everyone can get to them. We cannot ignore this thing, the iDock. Now this joystick, you push it in any direction and that's the direction the boat goes. Incredible maneuverability, and yes, push the joystick sideways, the boat moves sideways, like properly sideways. We're going to cover that later on when we do the engines review. And I've also got these outboard controls out in the cockpit where I've got an outdoor helm so I can drive the boat from out back when I'm amidst the fishing. Down here, nice handy addition. This is just a little stick-on Fusion remote so we can adjust the volume, skip tracks from the cockpit. It's waterproof, and the great thing about it is when your mates keep changing the music, you want to be in control, you just twist it off, put it in your pocket, and then you've got the power with you. Just takes a little wee battery. And we'll cover the full Fusion stereo review because there's some pretty cool stuff going on with the stereo. Like, some real cool stuff. Which brings us to this utility space. I didn't have this on my last boat, and I don't know how I did without it. It's just good. People put their phones there, day storage. Anything that comes in and out of the drawers can pop straight back up on there. Guys have their phones on charge because we've got USB ports just here. Speaking of USB ports, if we go inside the drawers, all of my drawers have got USB ports and 12 volt charging ports. So for camera batteries, VHF, handheld radios, cell phones, anything that needs to be stored, rechargeable torches even, can be plugged in so they're fully charged. I mean, right away, one of the camera crew have got a camera battery on charge, sits inside the drawer. So any of your rechargeable electronic equipment that lives in a drawer is on charge constantly in its cradle. And the drawers, they're just on nylon sliders. They're really simple, nice, simple wooden finish on the front. Tackle, I mean, look at the size of some of these drawers. I mean, look how much more unused room I've got in there. I mean, I've got more space than I've got fishing gear, and that's the first time I've ever said that about a trailer boat. Really functional, everything locks away. This bottom drawer here, if we open this up, RSE ice maker, so I can make ice on board. So for those extended stay away trips, I've got ice, that's all plumbed in and wired up, so that just makes ice. This thing ticks away, you get to choose the size of your ice that it makes. This is making medium size cubes. It draws pretty low current really. I mean, it's, while you're making ice, you're only 5.5 amps. If you're harvesting ice, just over 6 amps, and it makes 12 kilograms of ice in 24 hours, and that just ticks away there, and you can just grab the ice as you need it. So for those extended stay away trips, that's really handy. And speaking of staying away, indoor stove, outdoor barbecue. The boat's all wide open, which is how I use it as the day boat, and 90% of the time I don't need any curtains, but it's adaptable for this boat. So first off, I can have a side curtain here. So there it is, all rolled up out of the way. Starts getting choppy. So with the side curtain down and secured in position, if it's winter, if you've got a big sea coming in on the side, it just affords your passengers a little bit more protection from the wind, the cold, and the spray. Any spray of water that comes on here, it's fully sealed up. It's gonna run down and just track away down the corner of the cockpit so everybody stays that little bit drier. But when you want to go fully enclosed, it's just a case of pulling the zips down. And now we are fully enclosed, all snug and warm. And of course, when it's too warm, we've got zip out mesh inserts. We've got mesh that goes across the windows and on the front hatch so we get good airflow. And now we've got a fully enclosed area which sleeps four people. And then we can just move straight on inside here to the helm chair. So Stabycraft helm chair slides back and forward, twists like all good helm chairs should. Bolster seat, so when it's down, normal seat. When it's up, great leaning post. And the pedestal that it's sitting on is an Airwave pedestal. So the Airwave pedestal allows you, with a little adapter, to pump air, more air in it, or let air out, and it measures it. And that depends on the weight of the person sitting in the chair, how rough it is, and your preference, just how soft you like it. We've got a customized helm station here. I like to have plenty of storage area here for things like my phone, binoculars, all of that sort of stuff. Cup holder, when you're having driving the boat, you can have a beverage, of course. It's where I keep my Furuno autopilot remote. We'll get to that, that's incredible. Now, in my sitting position here, my natural hand position is right here on this trackball, and that's what I use to control the WASP unit. It's also touch screen, but it's just out of reach at times if I'm not standing. So I can just scroll around, and it's just got left click, right click. Anything that I want to do on that screen, I can do it with this. And the WASP's actually got a really good intuitive system, drop down menus. So yeah, nice and simple. Right here, right next to the control station for the Evinrudes. Again, these are excellent, so smooth, fly by wire. We're going to cover that off with the engines. Right here, cell phone holder, scan strut cell phone holder. Very easy to install, just mounts on the dash. And the good thing about that, one hand, clips in, it's sitting there, and it charges while it's sitting there. So while I'm here, I can have my phone in a place while it's charging. I have it on display. I can run all of my music playlists, SST charts, weather reports, anything like that, and it just becomes another instrument on the dash. And the really cool thing is it's charging the whole time. Furuno rotor key, this allows me to control my TZ Touch here as well without having to use a touch screen in case my hands are dirty. And I can control both the TZ Touch and my autopilot and just my key switches here, my navigation lights and bilge pumps, which are really the only things I need to use from the helm. The others are on the pillar behind me where everyone's got access to them. Trim tabs, engine starts, voltmeter so I can monitor my batteries, gas detector, and like all my other electronics gear, Furuno VHF, not only do they perform incredibly well, with the Furuno all being the same, they all plugged in, they interface and they talk to each other as well, which enables AIS, which means if there's any other boats in the area with AIS, I can see them come up on my chart plotter. The Furuno TZ Touch, you'll know I'm a big fan just because of the ease of use and functionality and the sounding goods. But over here, something real new for this boat, a WASP. One word, unbelievable. 120 degree wide beam. So in real layman's terms, when I was out the other day, I think I was in 45 meters of water, I was marking snapper 70 meters either side of me. That's how wide the beam is. It's got great deep water functionality. I've had it out sword fishing, operating crystal clear picture in 650 meters of water on the bottom. But added to that, everywhere you go in this boat, up to 350 meters of deep of water, it scans the bottom and draws a 3D model onto your chart that you keep, which is incredible. Just the amount of detail you're able to get in 3D, let alone the fish finding capability. And this one is the big boy unit, 24 volts. Because we work with the guys at Stabycraft to build a special pod into the hull of this boat, we've been able to reduce any turbulence over the transducer. And the results we're getting out of this thing are incredible. We are 3D mapping the sea floor while we're doing 35 knots, which is incredible. Everywhere we go, we're drawing our own charts over the top of existing charts. Now, just to finish off the goodies that we've got in here at the helm, we've got the Fusion Apollo stereo head unit up there. That's hooked into the amplifiers and speakers that go right around the boat. We've got my Evinrude iCommand gauges, which give me all sorts of data on the engine performance, tank levels, oil levels, all of that sort of stuff, trip logs. And next to it there, the Lumashore lights.
They are absolutely incredible. They'll be covered in our lighting review. And I will point out that all of these are NMEA compatible. So they're all hooked into the Furuno, and I can in fact control the stereo, I can control on my TZ Touch, as well as see all of my engine gauges, engine data, fuel flow, everything, monitor my tanks, everything can be done from the one TZ Touch here, because everything is hooked into it. And moving up here, we've got the main forward V-berth area, which is a full bunk. Now, one of the things I really love about this boat, not so much for the fact that it makes it a bigger bunk, you can just click these little levers here, and it folds down to make the bunks bigger, giving like ample room. I mean, hey, that's sort of queen size bed size. Each of these clip and fold up individually, but when all three are all clipped up and into place, what we've got now is a padded room. We've got this bulkhead here that's padded, padded bottom, around the sides, so any of your gear, like when we throw our cameras, fishing rods, all of that sort of stuff that normally gets stowed up on a bunk, once it starts bouncing around, all of that stuff just comes back, smashes you in the shins, or breaks on the ground. With this system here, 90% of the use of this boat is a day boat. It just gives me a real functional storage area where everything can just be chucked up the front and it's not going to bounce around. It's all well contained. Now, when I was talking about storage before, check out the storage on this bad boy. So all of my storage areas, got life jacket, grab bags, all that sort of stuff in there. That's a huge capacity in there where I keep my gas cookers, safety equipment. All of the storage areas I've got on gas struts. You know, when you're out in the boat, you're gonna want two hands to get at stuff. So storage areas, all of the hardware and computing for all the electronics are stowed neatly and rigged beautifully underneath there. Underneath this front one here, I've got a nice little bulkhead, and I've got 3 10 liter water containers. Because one of the things I didn't put on this boat was a water tank and a water pump. Again, for the 95% of the days that I'm not staying out on the boat and I don't need running water, why carry around that water tank, the extra water, the pumps and the electronics, when really, if I'm staying away, I need extra waters. I can just rip one of those containers out with a nice little tap on the bottom on the utility table. I've got running water when I want it. When I don't want it, it's up here, out of the way. And another reason that I've got such good storage under here is I don't have a black water holding tank and a toilet. When you've got a toilet on a boat, you've got to have all the tanks to contain all of the stuff that goes down a toilet so it can be pumped out when you're further out at sea. And let's face it, you're in a cabin of a trailer boat. Who wants to be in here when your mate's taking a dump? Up here again, glove compartment, throwing stuff that won't bounce out. Every compartment on this boat has got USB ports, so you can plug your phone in. Drink holders, more storage around the side. Now, this seat here, multi-purpose seat, it can be used in a number of ways. First off, this big, nice big bolster, standing, good holding on position against the base of the back, really comfy. Folds down, seated position, facing forward, kicking back, having a yarn with the skipper, or my personal favourite, bolster back up. We drop this down, and this is your spot for kicking back, watching the lures when you're trolling. And one more position, full bed. This is the third berth. The whole bench sits on 2 airwave pedestals, so as a seat you got suspension, as a bed you got suspension, nice rolled up ledge as well, stop you rolling out of bed in the middle of the night. And if you're worried about the size of it, it's big enough to handle a 6'6" world heavyweight boxing champ. Hey. And it's also big enough to be a bench seat for 3 people. And because I'm utilizing all of the space on this boat, when I click that up in the back here, I've got a place for my wiring gloves, release knife, a nice little organized place with all of my leaders. All fits nice and compactly out of the way. You've got things on hand when you want them, where you want them, and when you don't want them, don't have them on the boat. For instance, you could have a nice clean open space like this. You could have a rubbish bin here. You could have some extra cold storage with another Icytec bin for your lunch, beers, or another comfortable seat. Or you might even want to use the space for having icy cold beer on tap. delicious, fresh, icy cold beer on tap. Every boat needs one of these. Although when you are having a nice cold draft beer, there's just one other thing that you need. Live sport.
That's a thunderbolt.
Oh, got him. He's got him, he's gone. 10 and over they need now.
Of course, when you're out trolling in the open ocean, no matter where you go, thanks to the TrackVision TV1 on top of the boat, I get full sky channels, satellite coverage anywhere I go. And I can play it via this removable television, and I can also play it live on my Furuno Sounder. I can have it as a combination of plotter, gauges, watching TV, keeping my eye on the cricket or the live rugby, as well as keeping my eye on where I might catch my next fish. All done with a delicious, icy cold draft beer. But like everything else on this boat, when you don't need it, you just pack it away. So let's get back to the more serious fishing components. Obviously loads of space in this boat. It's foremostly a fishing boat. That's where its bones are. So lots of open space, move people around, walk around again, comes around this other side. Plenty of room underneath the combing for spare guns, tag poles, gaffs, camera poles, all of that sort of stuff. Now the rod holders. Here's something really cool. Chuck your rod in your rod holder. This is how I might use a bent butt on an electric reel. You can leave the rod in the rod holder, the bent butt sits out there. I've got electric reel plugs underneath here. We can winch away, that's great. You get your fish up or you need to rebait your rig, you can't reach the rod tip. That's where these Exploding Fish Evolution 360 rod holders are amazing. Push on it, look at that. Rotate 360 degrees. So you can spin the rod around. As soon as you get go, it locks. And I mean it locks. You can grab your bait, rig, whatever you like, swing the rod around, have it in whatever position you like. We're going to cover off the rod holders and how they relate to the outriggers and all the other fishing gear on the boat and how it's all integrated later on when we do the full fishing review of this boat. But for now, I'm just going to finish the tour of the boat. Live bait tank, it's a must have. Two tuna tubes, nice and deep, so that way the tail of the fish doesn't break the surface and splash water everywhere. Bait station with rod holders. So when I'm steaming my bent butt rods, this is the perfect place to store them. I've got my Talikas up here now. Knife storage for 6 knives. I also keep things like cutters up here when I need them on hand. Nice little holder here for my bait needles. So nice and accessible. Couple of drink holders and this little bit of equipment here. Line feeder. So bait needle, whatever I'm rigging up, I've got my rigging thread, I can cut off, use whatever I need. Cutters can go up there, bait needles there, everything's on hand. The bait board itself, now nice and wide, and at the centre of it all is the drawer. Now the drawer's been carefully thought about so it fits all of my leaders and everything's organised. I believe with fishing, everything should be in its place, so when you need something, you know where it is. It's pretty workmanlike in the way I've laid it out. My Shimano tackle boxes all fit. I've got all my necessary tools right at hand. And when I push it closed, we've got a little bit of redundant space here at the front. So if any water should be left open, drips down, it's not going to go into your drawer and you're going to keep salt water off your gear. It seals up beautifully. Now, the bait board itself, where we do all of our cutting and stabbing and maiming, there's a lot of juice and guts and blood and stuff that's on here that you don't want to end up in the boat. So along the front edge, a lot of bait boards have an upstand to stop everything tipping into the boat. This one, we've eliminated that. We've made it nice and flat. Now the reason for that is when you're skinning a fish or you're cutting along the bottom, if there's an upstand, you can't get your knife underneath it. And it really irritates me. So we've made a drain around it. And we've actually kept the height of the board just above the edge there, so when you're skinning you can still get your knife down there. Just another nice simple idea, and it's a perfect place for rigging your baits, chopping your baits, stitching up swordfish baits, or even my personal favorite, bait board sashimi. Okay guys, also while we're at the back of the boat, now underneath here, plastic bin. I like utilising every single inch of space on this boat for storage and for things like burley pot lines. Now I've got my skippy lures, I've got plastic fittings, rod straps, live bait tank net. They can all fit in there. It's made of plastic. You can slide and push them away. I've got another one made for this bit of space. It's just a way of utilising your space nice and easy. I just sketch up the dimensions of the space I've got, flick it to the guys at High Tech, and they make these bins up for me. And I've done it with the last few boats that I've had. Just a great utilisation of space. Down here we've got the washdown hose. Coils up so it packs away neatly, but it stretches out all the way out so I can wash down right up the front of the boat, high pressure. Runs off the washdown pump. And while we're down here looking at the deck, you'll see this measuring thing that's been routed into the deck. And that's just a nice place to be able to get a nice fish, put it down on the deck, wet the deck, take a photo, let it go, and we've got a measurement of it. So we've had that incorporated that into the design of the deck, and we're able to have input into how this U-Deck is designed. It's a great product, the U-Deck. It's a stick-on product. You can get it modelled up and customised. It's great underfoot, easy to clean. You can wear bare feet all day because it doesn't really absorb the heat, and it also dampens down the noise in the boat. So it's a great product to really finish the boat off and give it a nice touch. Here, another nice big locker where I can keep all my cleaning equipment and spare stuff. And in this locker here, the batteries. Big boys. My mates at Exide that have been looking after me for a number of years now, leaders in marine batteries. These big things here are the house batteries. Now, they're huge, and they're in fact almost the same sort of, well, they are the same style battery that people will use when they're running solar power on their house. So they're a deep cycle battery. There's a lot of equipment on this boat, so it's being drawn down all the time. So it's important that they're kept topped up. So I've got the solar panel on the roof, and whenever I'm at home, I plug into mains power. And I've got the single unit installed up under the bunk that keeps those batteries, those house batteries, topped up, because there's a lot of load on them when I'm running all of this equipment and all of my pumps. And I also get a heck of a lot of charge from these things, the E-Techs. The E-Techs have class-leading charging ability. They're alternators. They've got dual charging circuits. So I've got four charging circuits coming off those outboards. I've got them topping up these house batteries, which I've got two of. And under each combing, a dedicated start batteries for each engine as well. So I don't ever want to be out at sea worrying about running a bit out of power, because it's not the sort of place you can pull over and get a jump start. So loads of power, and like everything else on this boat, I've gone for overkill, over spec, and best in class. And talking of best in class, right at the very back of the boat is the power plant. I've gone for twin engines this time. That gives me the ability to have the iDock. It gives me a little bit of extra grip in the water. You are compromising a tiny bit of economy when you're going from a single to twins. And when you're talking about economy and all the other things that we really care about, low emissions, the E-Techs are best in class for all of them. But to find out more about the Evinrude G2s, just check out the Evinrude G2 review that incorporates iDock, and you can hear about all of the benefits and how in particular I've set them up on this boat to make it the ultimate power plant you could possibly have on a boat like this. And just looking at it quickly, it's reminded me of something. If you haven't noticed the amount of carbon fiber, we've wrapped the boat in a carbon fiber style, but one of the things we've done is we've incorporated water droplets, and that's because most boats end up wet. So when people are looking at them, we've put water droplets on there, and well, it looks pretty badass. Let's go take a look up here. Okay, now we come up and take a look on top of the boat. Now, taking up most of the real estate up here is the solar panel. Now, that's when the motors aren't running and pumping all that charge into the battery, at least I'm getting my batteries topped up with a trickle charge from the solar panel that runs through the power regulator. Right at the front there, I've got an open radar, which we're going to cover when we do our electronics review. Bird radar, one push. That is a big bit of kit to have on a trailer boat. That's really cool. Outriggers, these ocean blue outriggers, I've got them roof mounted to give me the extra height, and they are one hand operation. Swing out and you're fishing. Nothing has to be done to them. They're gonna be covered in the fishing review.
This bit here, the TrackVision TV1, that's what gives me all of my live sport and 114 channels wherever I am. And the WASP multi-beam, this is the locator, GPS signal that a lot of equipment utilizes. And in behind the anchor light, of course, the rocket launcher. Don't know why they call them rocket launchers. You don't launch rockets from them, you keep rods in them. And in this one, you can keep 11 rods, additional to the four that store in the bait board and the four down either side and the three at the front. We've got plenty of places to keep rods on this boat. And the aerials, over there, VHF aerial, but this aerial here, something a little bit special, that's for my Cell-Fi Go, the mobile repeater, which basically gives me extra elevation to hit cell towers. So I can take in a cellular beam, it takes it down to the Cell-Fi Go unit and gives me a wireless hub to boost the coverage that we're getting on board the boat that everyone can enjoy. Easy to operate from an app, you can switch between mobile providers, and it's allowed us to be out swordfishing and live stream while we've been fighting swordfish, which is pretty neat to be able to do that. And also, while we're at it, if you've got coverage, whether you've got a phone, tablet or a smart TV, ultimatefishing.tv, and you can see every tip that we've ever done and watch it wherever you go. If you haven't already downloaded the app, you should. Now, pretty much covered off everything on the boat, but there's that thing that we can't avoid. If we're spending 3 or 4 days away on this boat, you're gonna need to go to the toilet. We don't have a toilet on the boat, but we've got a few other options to cover it all off. So the bow rail up here, not only is it wonderful for fishing in design, but it also makes a wonderful urinal, great for blokes. And it's multi-heighted, so larger guys, this is your level. Toileting, long spread out urinal, great view, great ventilation. Smaller guys, not so much the reach, up on the platform. But then we've got to address the other thing, number twos. I mean, you could use a bucket, but so that really posed me with another design challenge. And I thought and thought, and then it was watching one of my mates fighting a fish in a fighting harness, and I came up with that eureka moment. We already had a natural toilet harness already on the boat. Game fishing fighting harness. You'll notice it's got a natural split. It's quite critical. You get a good split. Natural toileting position, and it becomes just less of a chore all of a sudden. You can actually go back to it being something quite special and enjoyable part of the day. And like all stylish vessels, there's more than one bathroom on board. This, the transom bathroom, again, extremely comfortable, good ventilation, and you get that wonderful atmosphere from the E-Tex. You feel like you're right amongst the action. You can swivel around, keep an eye on the lures, you can catch up on a bit of reading, you can still chat to the boys. I should point out too, fits all sizes, fully adjustable straps, so you know, you can sort of tighten up for rough weather to give yourself a bit of elevation out of the water. On calmer days, you can just lower right down and just, if you get it just right, you get the great bidet effect. The water just coming up there off the propellers, wonderful. It has really brought toileting on the boat to a new level for me. So there you have it, you've been right around my brand new Stabycraft 2750 that we've put a lot of time and energy into making what I believe is the ultimate trailerable sport fishing boat with a few extra nice little touches. Now, let's not forget that underpinning it all is the hull and ride and performance of Stabycraft and the build quality that I've trusted for 20 years now. I didn't want to change a thing from the hull from my last boat because that boat ate up the sea, and this one is exactly the same. So if you like stability, good ride, quality build, and a few of the nice extras, perhaps look up Stabycraft. And of course you're gonna wanna check out the action of all the fishing that this boat is capable of, and that I'm pretty confident it's gonna deliver on. So you can follow our adventures, as well as all the tips and tricks from short videos to full length videos at ultimatefishing.tv.